Last week, my intentions were to teach a one and done, which I don't remember the last time I did that, so I don't know what makes me think I could do it. I think I've forgotten how. But anyway, the title of the message was Grapes, Giants, and Grasshoppers. Everybody say grapes. Giants. Yeah, and grasshoppers. And the context for the scripture that I'll read to you here in just a moment is, it's from Numbers chapter 13. We use it a lot because there's just so much there we can glean from, because it speaks so much to the life that God's called us to live, to the opportunities that are in front of us, to live such a great life, to enter into such a great land, a good land, a land that flows with milk and honey. But the fact that there's going to be opposition there, and if you're not ready for the opposition, if you just, you know, you just don't think you have what it takes, and you're not willing to go in and face the giants that are in your life, as much as it's God's will for you to enter into the land and possess it and enjoy that great life, it's never going to be realized. And that was the case in the lives of the children of Israel. The people of Israel had been slaves in Egypt for 400 years. And so God, in his love for them, sends Moses to deliver them. And Moses comes to the people and he informs them that God has a plan for their future, just like God has a plan for your future, my future. And he says, I'm going to bring you out of Egyptian bondage, and then I'm going to take you into the promised land, into Canaan. It's a land that flows with milk and honey. And I told you that God brings us out to take us in. He doesn't just bring us out of our sin and then we just kind of struggle along until we get to heaven. God brings us out of that to take us into the great life that he has for us. Canaan is a good land. As I said, it's a land that flows with milk and honey, which means that it flowed with all kinds of abundance. It's a place of promise. It's a place of possibilities. It's a place where they can live and they can live great lives and they can prosper. When they arrive at the land, at the promised land, Moses sends 12 spies into the land to spy out the land, to see what the land's like, what they're going to face when they get there, to go in and possess it, what life is going to be like for them once they go in. And you know the story, they return, and they return with a cluster of grapes that's so large that two of them have to carry it between them on a pole. Now that's a cluster of grapes, isn't it? And that cluster of grapes was just an example of just how fertile and rich the land was. And it spoke to the people of the potential and the possibilities that existed for them in the land to live great lives and to flourish. Canaan, as I told you, is a type of our life in Christ. And so like Canaan, our life in Christ is filled with abundance, an abundance of good things, abundance of possibilities, abundance of what can be. Jesus in John 10:10 said, I've come that they might have life and they might have it more abundantly. We just quote that and we have an idea of life, but we don't have God's idea of life. And so when we read it, we hear one thing, and really what he's saying is something else. The word life there, I've come that they might have life, is the word Zoe. And it actually means the absolute fullness of life. So it's Jesus saying, I've come that you might have the absolute fullness of life. It also means the God kind of life. I've come that you might have life like God lives it, like I live it, in other words. And it also does mean eternal life. But we get the idea with eternal life that that's when we die and we go to heaven. Eternal life begins the moment you're saved. Amen? It begins the moment you're saved. That phrase, more abundantly, means superior in quality, superabundant in quantity. That's the kind of life God wants you to live, a life that's superior in quality. And why wouldn't it be? Because God is with you, and God is at work in your life, and God has given you these exceeding great and precious promises that he wants you to enjoy in your life. Amen? So why wouldn't your life be superior in quality to the person who's not serving God, and more abundant in quantity? And so we said this last week. This is really kind of what set it up. We just said, just as God had grapes for them in the land of Canaan, God has grapes for you in your life. And those grapes being symbolic of whatever it is that you need in your life, whether it's healing or financial provision or God to move in the life of a family member, God to turn a marriage around. God has grapes for you. Amen? Everybody say, God has grapes for me. But we also found out that there are giants in the land. And the spies, they, 12 words, they used 12 words describing how great the promised land was. And then I think they used some 150 or something like that to describe how great the challenges are going to be when they go into the land. How many of you know anybody that's like that? They acknowledge God, but after they acknowledge God, they want to tell you all these reasons why it won't work in their life. Amen? I'm telling you, this passage is so much like our lives, it's ridiculous. And in Numbers 13, 32 and 33, it says, and they gave the children of Israel a bad report. Everybody say a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants. And all of the people we saw in it are men of great stature. There we saw the giants. So there were giants in the promised land, giants that stood between them and the promise of God. And the same is true in our lives. There are always going to be giants that stand between us and the promise of God in our life. Whether it's a marriage, like my wife and I had, that needed to be healed, restored, there were giants. There were giants that we had to overcome, giants we had to defeat in order to go in and possess the land of a great marriage. There are giants that stand between you, the promise of God, and financial blessing. It isn't that God doesn't want to bless you financially. He does. But you think, well, why isn't he then? Because there are giants in the land. There are giants that stand between you and that promise, and you've got to go in and defeat him. Sometimes the giant is nothing more than just you living within your means. You conquer that giant. I mean, you know, you're well on your way to prospering more in life. Isn't that right? Are you all out there? So there's always giants. And if you're going to go in and possess the abundant life that Jesus came to provide you, you've got to defeat the giants. If you want to eat the grapes, you have to defeat the giants. Your greatest enemy, we're catching you up here, your greatest enemy isn't the giants that you face. It's how you see yourself. It really is. It's not the giants. The giants are really no problem. It's how you see yourself. In verse 33, it says, and we were like grasshoppers. And we were like grasshoppers in our own sight, and so we were in their sight. I started to put a grasshopper up on the screen and just remind you of what a grasshopper looks like. A grasshopper is a lowly animal, a lowly insect, isn't it? And I don't know what they're good for, quite honestly. We used to catch them when we were kids, and I just know this, when you catch them, they'll spit on you, right? And just whatever. But comparing yourself to a grasshopper, you're comparing yourself to something that's very small, very weak, obviously, and very incapable. So the 10 spies, they looked at the giants, then they looked at themselves, and they thought, well, compared to them, we're grasshoppers. Again, they saw themselves as grasshoppers. 400 years of slavery, think about it, had left them with this poor self-image, and so they saw themselves as weak compared to the giants. They saw themselves as weak, unable, no match for the challenges that they faced. Can I tell you, I think very much the same thing happens in our lives. And it's not that we're 400 years in slavery to Egypt. It's just that all of us start out our lives enslaved to sin, in bondage to sin. We live our lives apart from Christ, and so we're on our own. And on our own, we run into all of these challenges that we're absolutely no match for. And so we have this very poor self-image of ourselves, this very limited way of, again, seeing ourselves. They saw themselves as weak. I think we do. As unable. I think often we do. And so their bad report to Moses, if you think about it, and the people, was really based entirely upon how they saw themselves. God wasn't factored into their conclusion at all. Now, that's what's interesting about that is God had brought them through the wilderness, and on their way through the wilderness, think about all that he had done. First of all, he brought them out of Egypt with a mighty hand, the Bible says, the 10 plagues. Don't have time to repeat those. Parts the Red Sea, brings them across on dry ground. Their enemies come after them. They drowned. They get hungry, nothing to eat, so he brings manna from heaven. Come on. Manna is, what is it? Is actually what it is. What is this? But it was God feeding them. They were thirsty, so God brought water out of a rock. And get this, they actually faced enemies on the way, and as they did, God gave them victory over their enemies. Now remember, these are slaves. They didn't like to have a whole lot going for them, not a whole lot of weapons and artillery, whatever, like everybody else would, but God would just give them victory. So you would think when they'd get there, they would at least start including God a bit into their conclusion as to what they're able to do. Do you take God into consideration when you're facing the giants in your life? Can I tell you, if you don't, you're going to come up with the same conclusion that the 10 spies came up with. If you just look at your ability to do this on your own, through your own strength, your own wisdom, your own gifting and ability, you're going to say this: we're unable. We're not able to go up and possess the land. We just don't have what it takes. But how many know we should never factor any of our circumstances? We should never look at our circumstances and not factor God into it, because how many know God is with us? And would you agree with me that if God is for you, nobody can be against you? Amen? If God is on your side, it really doesn't matter who's against you. It doesn't really matter what life is bringing against you, because God can make a way where there is none. Come on. God can do what needs to be done in your life. Amen? As he's done probably many things for you in your life. So the spies say, we're not able. Caleb says, we are able. In fact, we're well able. And I asked you this question last week. I want to ask you again. Who was right? Were the 10 spies right? We're unable? Or was Caleb right when he said, we're well able? Because how many know you can't both be right? And I told you the answer to that is obviously Caleb was. Now they didn't think they were, but Caleb was obviously right, because 40 years later, after this unbelieving generation dies off in the wilderness, never going into the promised land, their kids grow up, and guess who they go in and possess the land with? Joshua and Caleb. And you know what? They were well able. Everybody say they were well able. So just because you think you're not able doesn't mean that you aren't. Amen. Because with God, you are able. Everybody say, I'm able. So more than any other factor, how you see yourself is going to determine your response to the challenges of life. The greatest enemy of the Israelites wasn't the giants. It was the way they saw themselves. And your greatest enemy isn't the giants that you're facing in your life either. It's the way you're seeing yourself right now. So the fight for your future, this is on the screen, I think. The fight for your future, listen to me, is more internal than it is external. Amen? Absolutely. And a grasshopper mentality will keep you out of the promised land. In fact, say that with me. A grasshopper mentality will keep me out of the promised land. The grasshopper mentality, just so you understand what I'm talking about, is a mentality that's a distorted image and view of yourself. It's you viewing yourself through the lens of your past, and we all have one, your failures, your shortcomings, your inabilities, your limitations. It's you viewing yourself as a mere unchanged man. And that's actually a phrase taken out of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3, where Paul is talking to them. He says, man, you are acting like mere unchanged men. He says, you're not. You're a new creation in Christ, but you're still acting like a mere unchanged man. I'm afraid we often act like mere unchanged men when we're facing challenges in our life. Amen? Forgetting the God that we serve. And forgetting who we are in Christ and what God has made us in Christ and the abilities that we have now that we are in Christ. Amen? And we act like mere unchanged men, worrying, fearing, just like mere unchanged men would. And so it causes you to underestimate yourself, what you're capable of with God's help, and it obviously will rob you of the life that God has for you. We use this verse a lot, Proverbs 23:7. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Now, that verse is neither negative or positive. It's just a statement of, as you think, so are you. So if you think of yourself negatively, if you see yourself as unable, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. But right on the other hand, change the way you think about yourself. Hopefully that's what you're doing coming to church. You don't think about yourself as you used to. You are spending time renewing your mind with God's word. You are beginning to see yourself in Christ Jesus. Amen? And so you're seeing yourself as who you are in Christ, as a child of God, as an heir of God, as a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ, as someone who is more than a conqueror in life. Amen? Yeah, that's all Bible. That's how God wants you to see yourself. So if you're going to defeat the giants in your life, you've got to change the way you see yourself. You got to see yourself in the light of what Christ has done for you. You've got to see yourself, as I just said, as a new creation. You've got to see yourself with God being for you. We say it, but do you see it for yourself with God being? No, I don't know if he's always for me. He's always for me. Well, how can you say that? Don't you mess up? I mess up, but he's still always for me. See, I used to think when I messed up, he wasn't for me anymore. And when you mess up as much as I does, he's not for you often. Come on, can I get a witness? And then I realized, you know what? Mess up or not, he's still for me. He may discipline me for what I've done. Come on. There may be a consequence. There will be a consequence to what I've done. Not by his hand. It's just the consequence of what I've done. Right? I talk hateful to my wife. There's a consequence there, right? You smoke, there's a consequence. I'm just pulling those out of my hat. Amen? But God's still for me. In fact, even when I'm messed up, God's convicting me. Well, that's him working on my behalf. Come on, Holy Spirit, say no, 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 no. Let's repent. Let's just forgive me, Lord. It is that, but it's in turning. Let's go a different direction here. Why? He's for me. He's endeavoring to get me on the right path. If he wasn't for me, he wouldn't be trying to get me back on the right path. God is always for you. When you fall the most, when you fall the hardest, you need to remember, God is for you. My dad, my stepdad, only dad I ever knew, he's a good dad. Tough, rough, smack you good. I don't know how many spankings I've had. I don't think I deserve very many of them, but I got them anyway. I did. I earned them every one. My dad one day said, "You get in trouble," because he knew what I was up to. He didn't know what I was doing, but he knew what I was doing. He said, "You get in trouble. You go to jail, you're going to be sitting there. I'm not going to come bail you out." So my dad, who was my stepdad, I get busted the first time for, I think it's 11 felonies, and then two later in a different county. And let me tell you who the first person was that came to my rescue. Did everything for me that he could. Mortgaged our home, had it paid off by selling land, which was a big deal to our family because we didn't have a lot. Had it paid off. And he went and borrowed three times more than he had paid for the house when he first had built it several years before, just to pay my attorney and get me out of trouble. It was my dad. You know what I found out? Dad might say he's not going to be there because he's trying to keep me from being ornery. But you know what? My dad loved me so much. I was just his stepson that he was there for me. You just do that for people that you love. And see, God loves you so much that he gave his one and only son for you. And he who spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not give us all things? He who spared not his own son, but delivered him from us all, how shall he not show up for you whenever you've just blown it and you've blown it big time? When you've blown it the worst is when you need to know God is there for me if I will just look to him. Amen? This isn't going the direction I'd hoped it for, but this, I have a feeling it's going the direction that it needs to go. Everybody say God is for me. You know what? He's not just for me, but he's also with me. He's in me and he's always working on my behalf. Do you know that? Is that how you see yourself? I didn't for years. You've got to see yourself indwelt by and empowered by the person of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. You've got to see yourself as able, as more than a conqueror. You've got to see yourself that way. The single most important thing you can do after you get saved is renew your mind with God's word so that you can begin to see yourself the way you're supposed to see yourself now that you are in Christ, to see yourself for who you are as this new creation in Christ, and begin to put on the new man, begin to put on the new you. Amen? Is this okay? Yeah. Again, what stopped these people from entering the promised land and receiving all that God had for them wasn't the giants. It's the way they saw themselves. They saw themselves as grasshoppers. And the way they saw themselves kept them from going in and possessing the land. Here's what I want you to realize. And this will be the focus today. And I'll wrap this up next time I teach. Listen to me. Because some of you won't like this when I say it, because you'll just, oh, no. But I'm right. Somebody says, well, I can disagree. You can disagree. You have the right to be wrong. You do. You are creating your future. Those people created their future. God didn't create their future, because he'd already said he wanted them to go up and possess the land. God did not create their future. Amen? The giants didn't create their future, because they didn't even go in and face the giants. They all wandered around in the wilderness until they... Moses, it wasn't the pastor that created their future. Life, here's what I've heard. Can I tell you, life happens to us all, and life... Similar things can happen to two different people, and it devastate one and ruin their life, and the other one, as you hear, take lemons and make lemonade out of it, and they just keep moving forward, and they keep, you know, claiming God's promises and just doing what God has for them to do. Amen? Really, I mean that. I'll give you an example. This is personal. This comes right home to us. My daughter and her husband, their second child was born a couple hours later, I'm holding him in my arms over at the hospital, Carl Hospital, and he has a seizure. And I thought he just had a chill, I thought that didn't look quite right. And then he has another one just a little bit later. And so I called my wife over there and I said, hey, watch this and see, what's going on? And as soon as she saw it, she immediately said, hey, we need to get everybody out of here. A couple of people from here were there. And we called in the doctors, and they took him immediately. And the rest from then on was downhill. I mean, he started having one seizure after another, was having over 80 or 90 of them a day, and said if they didn't get him stopped, they were going to kill him. They were infantile seizures, what they were called. They did stop. They did stop miraculously. But when they stopped, it left him where he has to be cared for all the time. He can't talk. He can't walk. He can't do anything on his own. My daughter has to take care of him. And my daughter and my son-in-law had great dreams. In fact, they went to Bible college, and she went to nursing later because he was a carpenter, and they were going to use the nursing and the carpentry to be able to get them into countries, foreign countries, where they could go and be missionaries and share the gospel while they were being nursing and while they were being a carpenter. Somebody think that's a great idea. It's a great plan. It was God. No doubt in my mind, it was God. But whenever my grandson was born, it changed the whole trajectory of their life. And they never did that. And it always bothered me. But, yeah, it did bother me. So 20 years pass, maybe, no. Yeah, no, 15 years pass. And we meet a couple who have almost exactly the same thing happen to them in their life. The difference is where... my daughter and her husband lived here, and actually lived in Tennessee, his family was there, so they could surround him, they could help him. We went, we helped him. We were involved in all of that for such a long time, still are. And this couple was in Mexico, and they were there becoming missionaries to Mexico. And she has the child there in Mexico. And the exact same thing happened that with our grandson happened to their son. And so the dad is so devastated by it that he starts walking the street and he's just praying, God, what do I do? You know, I feel like you sent us down here. Now this has happened. He's devastated by it, as you would be. And he said he just felt very much like God said, nothing changes. This is still will you stay here and I'll provide for you. And so for the last you know, whatever years, 15, 20 years, that couple has been a mission, not just a missionary to Mexico. Their ministry has grown and grown and grown and just increased. They just are, you know, they touch thousands of people's lives every year, and yet they have the exact same situation in their home. So I says, well, I wouldn't think you'd use that as an example. Well, that's because you don't know me very well. And I'm just real. I'm just, I feel like, you know, our life is probably, I can't talk about you and I can't talk about your life. You get mad. So I just tell you about mine. Can I tell you, from that example, I'm telling you, you create your future. Everybody say, I create my future. They saw themselves limited, the way they saw themselves limited God, and it limited them, just as it does. And their self-imposed limitations kept them from going in and possessing the land. They never tasted the grapes. Your future doesn't happen by chance. It doesn't happen magically. Your future doesn't already exist, and you just are kind of stepping into it. God doesn't create our future for us. How could you think that? Look at the lives some people are living. How could he have created? He didn't. And life doesn't create our future for us. Your future, my wife loved this comment. We heard somebody say it, so I stuck it in my notes today because she thought it was so good. Your future doesn't happen to you. It happens through you. Amen? If you don't get anything else I say today, your future doesn't happen to you. Your future happens through you. You're creating your future, whether you realize it or not. You're creating your future all the time, whether you're thinking about it or not. You're either creating your future by design or by default. You're either creating your future based on what God has promised you and based on what you believe to be the will of God for your life, and that's what you're going after, that's what you're believing God for, and you're not letting anything stop you. When giants are there, you defeat them. When challenges arise, you overcome them. This is what God said. This is what I'm going for. And you're creating the future that you're realizing. Or you're like the children of Israel and you're saying, I'm not able, I wasn't born with a silver spoon in my mouth, whatever that means. Come on, you're creating your future. And I'm out of time, so I'll wrap up by just telling you what I'm going to talk about next, okay? Here's the four things that create your future. Are you ready for this? Are there more probably? But your future is shaped by your thoughts. Proverbs 4:23. Be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by your thoughts. How many of you would not want the thoughts you think to be something that were readily accessible to anyone, everyone? How many of you are glad your thoughts when you come into the church don't just appear there on the screen with your name under it? This is what Don's thinking today, right? Or this is what Joe's thinking, or come on. Yeah, this is what Stacy is thinking. Sitting next to Ashley, I wouldn't even want to know what she's thinking at the moment. You know? Come on. How many of you are glad? Be careful how you think. Be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by your thoughts. So if you're careful about how you think and you think the way God wants you to think, you think positive, you think faith-filled thoughts, you think God's word, you think what God has for you in life. Man, your life is shaped by your thoughts. But if you're not careful how you think and you start giving place to the wrong things, thoughts, I can't do this. I just don't have what it takes. They just don't understand. They don't realize what I've come from. Be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by your thoughts. My wife doesn't care for me. My wife doesn't show affection. Be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by your thoughts. Amen? Your life is shaped by your thoughts. Your future is shaped by your thoughts. Your future is shaped by your choices. Your future is shaped by your choices. Deuteronomy 30:19, today I give you the choice. This is God speaking. Today I give you the choice, speaking to the Israelites, speaking to us. I give you the choice between life and death. It's your choice, between life and death. That sounds like an easy choice, doesn't it? And yet, how often do we get that choice wrong? I give you the choice between life and death, between blessing and curses. Well, that seems like an easy choice too. Who would choose curses? And yet, we do. Now, I call on heaven and earth to witness the choice you make. Oh, that you would choose life. I mean, this is God saying, here, let me help you. So help you make the right choice. Oh, that you would choose life so that both you and your descendants may live. Think about it. The Israelites chose to listen to the evil report of the spies rather than to listen to the promise of God that said, the land is yours. I'm giving to you, giving it to you as an inheritance. How many of you think when God gave him that promise that he might have known there were giants in that land? How many of you think when they got there and the spies came and they said, hey, there are giants in the land, God said, I didn't realize that. Now what are we going to do? Jesus, you are the Holy Spirit, got an idea. What are we going to do here? Did we have a plan B? Is there another land that doesn't have giants? How many think he might have known they were there? And you know what? When he said, I've come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. He already knows you got giants that you've got to conquer. But you're well able to conquer those giants. He will give you the ability to overcome every one of those giants, right? But you have to choose life. They chose to listen to that bad report. I thought about my choice of friends whenever I got old enough to make choices on my own. My choice of friends and how I chose to have fun, for that matter, almost landed me in prison. If it wasn't for the grace of God, I would have been. Now I'm very careful with my choices because I understand the power they have to affect my life. Can I tell you? The power of choice, I think, is one of the greatest powers God has given you. Think about that. You have the power to choose life or death, blessing or cursing. I don't know how you get much more powerful than that. Amen? Number three, I won't talk about those next week because you kind of get those. Your future is shaped by your faith. Your future is shaped by your faith. Go to Hebrews. When you get home, go to Hebrews chapter 11. Read the entire chapter. It's called the Great Faith chapter. The Hall of Fame is what it's referred to because it lists all these people and it talks about their faith and what their life was like, what they accomplished because of their faith. And they're people like us. They all had obstacles. They all had challenges. They all had giants that they had to overcome in their life. But then it tells you all of the things they did because of their faith. I'm going to read you a few of them. By faith, Noah. This is a biggie, man. By faith, Noah warned about things not yet seen. In other words, they haven't even ever happened. Nobody even understands it. In holy fear, built an ark to save his family. How many know Noah, through his faith, come on, created his future? Holy fear. He does exactly what God says to do, and he builds an ark. By faith, when Abraham, when called to go to a place where he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed. You know, that's funny. They both obeyed. And went, and though he did not know where he was going. So he didn't know where he's going, but this is what God told him. God said, head that direction, and he did it. He obeyed in faith. Would you agree with me that Abraham created his future when he stepped out that day and began his journey, come on, obeying God? He certainly did. Hebrews 11:11, this says about Sarah, and by faith, even Sarah wanted to include the ladies. Maybe you'll like this one. Maybe this is you. By faith, she's like 80 or so years old, who was past childbearing age. How many know you are past childbearing age at that age? How many of you, if you're 80 years old, you want to be past childbearing age at that point? Yeah. So it says, I want to be past it. Yeah, anyway, I won't touch that. By faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled. What? 80 years old? She was enabled to bear children. How? Because she considered him faithful who had made the promise. Sarah created her future with her faith. She was barren to that point, no children. Wanted children, but had no children. But God gave her a promise. when she's 80 years old, when it looked impossible, not only is her womb dead, but her husband's dead. He's shooting blanks. Somebody says, you didn't have to say that. I know, I just, there was this. No, I just wanted you to get the picture. But by faith, and some works, obviously, she got pregnant and she had a child. Everybody say, by faith. She created her future, didn't she? Listen to these. Listen to these people. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea. How'd they do it? By faith. As on dry land. Wow. Faith in God will enable me to pass right through impossibilities in my life, just like I'm on, like, dry ground, man. But when the Egyptians tried to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell. How'd they fall? What caused them to fall? Faith. Impenetrable walls. Walls that were so wide that you could race chariots, three widths of chariots around the walls. That's some big walls, some 30 foot tall. Walk up to that as a man and ask yourself, how in the world is this possible? Yeah. After the army had marched around them for 7 days, but yeah. By faith, the prostitute, the who? The prostitute, Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed when those who were disobedient. And what more shall I say? I don't have time to tell you about, and I don't. I'm like the writer here. I don't have time. I don't have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Japheth, and about David and Samuel and the prophets. Watch this. Who through faith, not great ability, not great wisdom, not their skills, but who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned into strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. How'd they do all that? How'd they do all that? How are you going to do what you do? That's the only way you're going to do it. You're either going to do it by faith or you're not going to do it at all. We overcome. This is a victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. You got to have faith in God. You got to believe that whatever God has promised you, he is well able, as Sarah did, to perform it. He's able to bring it to pass. You got to believe with God, nothing is impossible. Don't care what it looks like. Maybe walls, come on. Maybe giants. It just doesn't matter what skin it comes in. It doesn't matter what it looks like. My God is greater than any challenge I face. And by faith, I can overcome. By faith, I can conquer. By faith, I can subdue. Faith. So he says, oh, I just need more faith. No, you don't. You just need to use the faith you've got. You've got plenty of faith. You just got to use it. And I will close with this verse. I will. So when it comes to faith, Jesus didn't use giants because that wasn't what was in front of him. He used mountains. I think mountains might be bigger than giants. Mountains might be worse than giants. And they see Jesus do something. They see him curse a fig tree and it dies. The next day they walk by and they go, wow, that fig tree you cursed, it's dried up from the roots. How'd you do that? How'd you do that? How'd you do that, Jesus? How do you do that stuff, Jesus? And he said, have faith in God. Everybody say, have faith in God. Man, you talk about simple. That's, you just have faith in God. I'm your pastor today. I'm following Jesus' example. I'm just telling you, have faith in God. Well, how's this going to happen? Have faith in God. Well, how can I get out of this mess? Have faith in God. Amen? And then he tells you how faith works. So he tells you to have it. Then he tells you how it works. You need to know how it works. And he said, for assuredly I say to you, whoever, so who will this work for? Little old you, little old me. Assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Write this down. I'm going to tell you how faith works. It works so simple. Faith works by believing and speaking. That's how faith works. Faith works by believing and speaking. You believe with the heart. And whatever you believe in your heart, you say with your mouth. That's faith. It's what got you saved. But it's also what moves the mountains in your life. Faith will move the mountains in your life. You can't look at the mountain and say, oh, I don't know, the mountain's so big, the mountain's so bad. Your mountain's not going anywhere. Well, no, it's not going anywhere. In fact, it's getting bigger. You're adding to the mountain. You got to look at the mountain and you got to say what you believe in light of God's promise. In light of what you believe God's capable of doing, you got to believe it. And then you got to say, your mountain, you're coming down. No longer am I going to talk about how big and how bad that mountain. That mountain is coming down. In Jesus' name, the mountain is coming down. It's coming down. Our marriage problems are on their way to being over. It's going to be removed from our life. I believe and I say, you know what? Think about this. When you believe something in your heart and you start saying it with your mouth, you will naturally start moving in that direction. Amen? And if you'll stay with it, you'll have whatever you say. In fact, get this. There's only one part of that verse that always messed me up. And it's not going to mess me up any longer. You're going to love this. And it's the part where he says, for whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be removed, be outcast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart. And it just kind of seems like Jesus set us all up for failure right there. Because you're thinking, you know, I get it, God, but not to have any doubts at all, it's tough, Lord. It's tough. Now, maybe you can do it. I just never have been able to. My head will always, does your head do that? How many of you ever have a little doubt? And then you think, oh, I can't doubt. If I doubt, then it won't happen. Is that, come on. I know what you think. I've been there. And so I would think, you know, how do I not question how, God? And how do I not have just this inner uncertainty? I can't stop the birds of the air from flying over my head. God, the thoughts come, but how many know I can't stop them from flying over my head, but I can stop them from making a nest there? I don't have to sit there and entertain that. So get this. That word, when it says shall not doubt in their heart, it doesn't mean to question or to have uncertainty. It doesn't. That's what I thought it meant. That's not what it means. Get this. The phrase shall not doubt in his heart means this: to not withdraw or to quit. Here's what Jesus said. Listen, you got a mountain in your life, have faith in God. Believe God's able to move that mountain for you. Start speaking to that mountain. And whatever you do, don't withdraw from that. And don't quit. Don't quit believing. And don't quit speaking to your mountain. You know what? I can do that. I may not be able to stop every little doubt from flying over, but I can absolutely not withdraw and not quit. I can just keep believing and speaking. And he said, if you'll just not withdraw and not quit, you will eventually have what you say. Amen? That ought to make the faith of every person in here today stronger. Amen? Everybody say, don't withdraw. Don't quit. Keep believing. Keep speaking. All right, next week I want to talk to you about believing. Your believing creates your future. It really is what drives all the other things that I just talked about, and that's why I want to spend a week talking to you about it. Is this okay? Yeah. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand.